Morning, everyone. So we're welcome everybody here to the Ninth Circuit at Stanford. Okay, so we have for this morning session, we have three cases on the calendar. The first one, Curignani one, has been submitted on the briefs and record. And our first case for oral argument is United States of America versus Molen. Counsel?
I'm Jay Tony. With me at the table is Sandra Gillies, who until recently was Judge Mueller's senior law clerk. She's also my wife of 30 years. If there's any lucidity in the brief, it's because of her, not me. And if she throws something at me, it's because I said something stupid.
We'll keep an eye
all right.
on her.
Okay.
For you.
I'd like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal.
The clock is counting down. That's perfectly fine.
Okay. What I want to emphasize is about the core functions of an attorney in the colloquy for a Faretta. As we were coming down from Woodland, we were talking about the judge in this case focused on whether Molen had the skills to go through it. He never talked about what he's giving up, because really what we do as lawyers, especially in federal cases and criminal cases, is we analyze the case. We talk about the consequences. We try and figure out what the best resolution is. Just like a cancer surgeon who is treating a cancer patient, should we operate? It's your choice, but if you don't, we'd need this type of chemotherapy, and I say you should do this. And when somebody just goes into the trial mode and advising a pro per defendant,
Where did he go wrong? I don't quite.
Tell me what he left out.
What didn't he advise or warn Mr. Molen that he should have? What was missing from the admonition?
I think what was missing in this case was any real understanding that he was missing the ability of an attorney to independently evaluate the evidence. Talk about the consequences.
Well, he told him that, look, it's not to your advantage to proceed pro se without a lawyer.
True, but you also
have
to say, I would think, why? What are you missing?
Well, he told him that he'd have to know the rules of procedure and the rules of evidence, and that his attorney would know those, and he might not be familiar with them. And your client said, oh, no, I've studied the rules of evidence and
right,
rules of procedure.
Right, at the Salmon Club, I know that. But what I'm trying to emphasize is that's the trial part of it. And if you're going to really advise somebody why they need a lawyer, you should be able to say, also, you're not getting independent analysis of the evidence. You're not getting advice as to the possible consequences of pleading, negotiating, none of that, which is really what we do more than try cases in federal court, because our clients are kind of hopeless when we get to the jury.
But this was at the time of trial, was it not?
Actually, I believe you'll find that what happened in this case, as I understand it, is that the public defender and Molen had a parting of the ways because he wanted a sovereign citizen defense,
right.
Mr. Petrick said, I'm not going to do
but
that.
But how close to trial was the Faretta colloquy?
Quite a ways, because then I came into the case and I don't have the...
You mean the trial was further down the road?
Way down the road.
Okay.
Yeah, because then the federal defender's office did not want their attorneys to be advisory as a matter of policy. I got the call. I've dealt with other what would be called tax protesters, and we went from there.
So, what do we do with the fact that there was an advisory council after he was allowed to go pro se?
What didn't I actually jumped in when he was sick and asked questions.
That was at the trial.
That was in the trial, but that was
no.
For
but your point though was about that there are other advantages to having a lawyer. Pre-trial, such
yes.
as you just said, negotiation, understanding the evidence,
right.
assessing
yes.
what you're going to do at trial and whatnot.
That's right.
You were there, right, at that time? So what do we do with that?
Well, I wasn't in a position to advise.
Well, but if he had a question, he could call you up and ask you, right?
Yeah, but that doesn't solve the problem of the colloquy with the judge, as I see it.
I'm trying to understand, what is the problem with the colloquy?
You're asking us to adopt a rule that a judge has to say in addition to the things that this judge said. By the way, another disadvantage of representing yourself is you won't have independent counsel on a whole variety of issues.
Yeah.
Isn't that self-evident?
No. Not to the average person.
Well, isn't a disadvantage of not having a lawyer that you won't have a lawyer?
What I'm trying to say is, and our position is, that what is important in the colloquy is whether he can get through trial. Do you know the evidence? Do you understand how to object? The person in trial will be experienced, and you'll be at a disadvantage. What's missing, and frankly, what often happens in cases, even with difficult defendants, as I'm sure you see occasionally, is that the attorney can bring somebody like Molen, who is sort of out there with his belief system, down to earth by counseling and showing different situations. With Molen, I was advisory counsel. I'm not in the position, and the judge didn't indicate to him that he's missing out on those core functions of a lawyer.
Let me ask you a question. We often see these cases in the reverse context, which is to say, the judge denies self-representation and the defendant comes up to us and says, I've been denied my Sixth Amendment rights. If we got this colloquy and the judge denied self-representation, wouldn't we have reversible error?
I think...
The judge was careful to say you shouldn't be representing yourself. It'll hurt you. Your attorney can, you know, he did a bunch of things. He didn't do all the things you wanted.
Right.
But my sense is that if this case had come up to us in the opposite context, we would say, no, the judge improperly denied the defendant his right to self-representation.
Well, I think if the colloquy had been further advanced and it was denied, yes. I'll tell you what would be nice. We have a ironclad way of pleading people guilty in federal court. It's in the rules. It takes care of every possibility. It would be nice if there was a script that was fashioned by the circuit. And if that happened, I would like it to also say you're missing out on independent analysis.
I mean, there should be a script for district judges when they're taking a waiver on a counsel.
But
I still want to know what is missing. What do you think he should have? What's the key part that he should have said? The district judge.
Okay, I think he should have definitely said that there's more to representation than the rules of evidence and the trial. That as far as preparing a case, analyzing the likelihood, the possible consequences if you go to trial, all the stuff that's pre-trial, you're missing out on. And that's a very important core function of an attorney.
Had Mr. Molen already had the advantage of that independent analysis with the public defender's office, who seemed to, I mean, as I look at this case in retrospect, he wanted to assert a sovereign citizen defense, and the public defender said to him, essentially, that's crazy, and they parted ways.
But I can't tell you what Mr. Petrick said to
Sure.
Mr. Molen, and whether they even got that far, I don't know. So
you had two other issues. Did you want to address either of the other issues, the good faith defense and the unanimity instruction?
I'd rather keep my exactly 2 minutes, which comes up in 1 second.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court. Sherry Haas on behalf of the United States. This appeal should be viewed through the lens of the Supreme Court's concern in Feretta that the Sixth Amendment provide for counsel that is an aid to a willing defendant and not interpose between a defendant and his right to represent himself, interposes an organ of the state between the defendant and his right to represent himself. Here, the defendant validly exercised his right to represent himself by making a knowing, intelligent, and unequivocal waiver. And while this court has held, for example, in Hayes and Neal, that no specific colloquy is required, the court adequately advised Molen of the disadvantages he faced.
Do you think a defendant really understands what it means to go without counsel?
I think that Molen understood what it meant without counsel.
Do you really think defendants, you know, appreciate what it means to what they're facing if they proceed without counsel?
Can a defendant fully appreciate what they're facing without counsel, having not been counsel themselves? Probably the answer is no. But the role of the court isn't to explore every possible facet of what somebody is going to go without when they go without counsel. Because, in fact, if the court goes too far, as the Seventh Circuit noted in Arai, then the court is going to be accused of putting its thumb on the scale, of scaring a defendant from exercising his right most, to represent himself.
Most district judges would prefer not to have pro ses.
I think that's
in a criminal trial.
I think that's right, Your Honor, and I think the reason.
So if you give a very thorough and complete advisement, maybe the defendant will think twice.
I think that's the purpose of the Feretta colloquy. I think that the reason that most district judges would prefer not to have a defendant go pro se, besides the general issues that it brings up at trial, is that when a defendant exercises his right to represent himself, the court is inevitably between a rock and the hard place. And I think either way, there's likely to be an appeal, which this court recognized in the Meeks case.
Does a defendant have a pretrial right to represent himself?
Prior to trial?
Prior to trial.
I'm not sure.
Part of your opponent's argument is that he missed the counseling and other things that might have occurred during trial, but also before trial. Does a defendant have a pretrial right to represent himself under Feretta?
I don't think so.
At the arraignment, he could say, Your Honor, they say, here's public, can you afford counsel? And the defendant says, no, well, here's the public defender. And the defendant could say, I don't want any attorney.
I
don't want a lawyer at all. I'm going to handle this case on my own. And then it gets sent to the district judge to do a colloquy and to take a waiver.
That's correct.
And you start out, but you can start out from the very beginning without the assistance of counsel. And usually at that point, the district judge will appoint investigators and think about appointing a standby counsel.
Yeah, and I guess my question is slightly different. Judge Pius is quite correct in working through. Could a district judge say, I'll allow you to represent yourself at trial, but I won't allow you to represent yourself during the investigative phase of the case? And would that violate Feretta?
I think, I don't know any cases that are on point. I think that it would, because I think that it would speak to the Feretta concern that a lawyer not be imposed on an unwilling defendant. And I think here, Molen, in a post-Feretta colloquy, stated that he had chosen to represent himself for a reason. And I think that that's telling, because I think that it goes to his strategy at trial.
Can you address the instructions? I know your opponent wanted to save time and deal with other matters, but do you agree that the jury should have been told that it had to be unanimous on the corrupt act, if you will, with respect to each of the two counts?
No, Your Honor. And in fact, just yesterday, I filed a 28-J.
Right, I saw that.
What was it, Sorensen? Yeah.
Yes, Your Honor. And I think the Tenth Circuit got it right, which is that Richardson, which the defense cites, relates specifically to the elements of the continuing criminal enterprise statute. But Richardson distinguished between elements and means. And the 7212A statute, the IRS obstruction statute, is a continuing course of conduct crime.
So a jury needs to be unanimous on elements but not means.
Correct.
Let me ask you a question. Does it matter here? Don't we know that the jury found two wrongful acts?
That's right.
It found that these two tax liens had been filed. We knew they unanimously found that. They would be appropriate means, would they not?
That's correct.
They were alleged as means in the indictment?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes, they were, yeah.
So that even in the absence of the instruction, we can look at this record and be certain the jury was unanimous on two of the alleged means.
That's correct, Your Honor. If you look at, first of all, the standard of review is plain error. And I think given the lack of precedent for unanimity instruction, there is no plain error. In addition, there's also
No prejudice.
He received a fair trial.
Well, there's another circuit that has a model instruction that requires or asks the jury to delineate, you know, which facts supported.
That's correct, Your Honor.
May be one of the dangers of self-representation.
As the United States noted in its brief, there are a review of the circuit's standard jury instructions revealed that I think at least one circuit does require unanimity. However, other circuits do not, and in light of the Tenth Circuit's ruling, I think at best there's a circuit split, although I don't think so.
But I guess what I'm asking is,
why should we reach that issue?
What we review under plain error, and we know in this case that there was no prejudice from failure to give the instruction because the jury unanimously found two of the alleged means.
That's
and
correct.
And therefore, we really don't have to decide whether or not the instruction is required, do we?
Even if we assume
it was required, there cannot be prejudice in this case, given the jury's
finding. Substantial rights were not infringed.
That's exactly right.
I thought it was interesting when I read this, the briefs and parts of the record in this case, that it turned out at the trial, even though he was pro se, he actually had assistance of counsel at trial, correct? It was more like a hybrid kind of thing.
That's correct, Your Honor.
That doesn't happen very often.
No, in fact,
it's rare that ever happens.
That's correct. And in fact, I believe that some circuits don't allow it because it's considered prejudice not to the defendant, but to the government, because the defendant then has the right to conduct the entire trial and also testify.
But no, there was no objection to this arrangement in this trial, was there?
No, Your Honor.
The briefs suggest that perhaps Mr. Molen may have been confused by the role of standby counsel. I know the judge gave a pretty good admonition that standby counsel was just there to stand by in case the motion was granted. But once standby counsel assumed that other role, was that admonition somehow undermined?
I think that once the counsel assumed a greater role.
It was probably to Mr. Molen's benefit.
To Mr. Molen's benefit. Mr. Molen had already validly waived his right to counsel, and I'm not sure that the admonition was undermined so much as
he received
the benefit of counsel.
My question is a little different. Was counsel's participation one of those interpositions of the state between the defendant and counsel that you say we should guard against?
No, because here, unlike other cases that the defense had cited, there was no disagreement that was apparent between the defendant and his attorney. He stood side by side with his attorney and tried that case together.
And Mr. Molen never said, wait a minute, I don't want this guy speaking. It's my case.
That's correct. He in effect, represented himself and fully benefited from being represented by counsel.
And the judge was okay with it. The judge didn't
Yes.
put a stop to it.
Yes, and the government did not object either.
Okay. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
Rebuttal?
About all I did in that case was step in when he was sick so we could get through, and I asked the questions. But I didn't have any control. You've read the record. I don't think...
No, I was just no, it was more of an observation than anything else.
I understand. But the fact that with his consent, was asking questions on a very limited part of the trial, I don't think answers the question, because the whole proceeding was orchestrated by him. And That's what I think was...
Usually the judges keep a sharp distinction between standby counsel and advisory counsel. And advisory counsel is just that. And standby counsel steps in and takes over completely.
That's right.
And here it was something in between. I didn't mean to distract you. Did you want to respond to the argument, the government's argument on the Feretta?
I think I've said what I need to say about Feretta. I think that I'd emphasize that there should be a model in the circuit. It might save a lot of these back and forth, and it should emphasize the core functions prior to trial.
Do you have any response to the government's argument on the jury instruction?
I'll submit on that.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, counsel. Matter submitted at this time.